Okay, we're moving on to the next video in the chapter 3, Molecules of Life. We're going on to lipids. Almost all carbohydrates are hydrophilic. Remember that, what that means, water-loving, that dissolve in water. There's several different types of lipids we're going to look at. And they're really different. The one thing they all have in common is they're very hydrophobic. They don't mix with water. It's like oil or fat. You put it into water, they don't mix. They could put oil and vinegar. Vinegar is mostly water. Oil and vinegar, they don't mix. You can shake them as much as you want, but they'll layer out. Okay, there's the oil, there's the vinegar. They also differ from carbohydrates, proteins, and nucleic acids in that they're neither huge macromolecules nor are they necessarily polymers. They're pretty big molecules. The triglycerides, the major dietary fat, it's a pretty big molecule. So I kind of disagree with this, but they're not huge macromolecules like starch. And they're not necessarily polymers. They're a diverse group of molecules made from different molecular building blocks. And we'll basically go look at three of them, triglycerides, steroids, and phospholipids. Okay, so typical fat or dietary fat, call it triglyceride. And it's tri, so there's three of something, three fatty acids, plus a molecule of what's called glycerol. And these are put together the same way you put together glucose molecules to make carbohydrates with dehydration reactions. Okay, there's the the glycerol on the left, three carbon molecule, and then there's the fatty acids on the right, three of them. And fatty acids are long chains of carbon and hydrogen. And they're usually 16 to 18 carbons long, each one of them. And what you do is you add fatty acids to the glycerol molecule with dehydration to get, if you do it once, that's a monoglyceride. You put two fatty acids on, diglyceride. You put three fatty acids on, that's a triglyceride. And that's basically what dietary fat is, a triglyceride. Okay, here's putting on the first one to make a monoglyceride, and there's the three to make a triglyceride. So fats perform essential functions in the human body. One thing is energy storage, and they store more energy than anything else. So they have really good energy, and it's like long-term energy storage. Like if you stop eating for several days, what are you gonna live on? You're gonna live off of the fat that you've stored in your body. Cushioning, and lots of things are cushioned. Your kidneys, for example, are cushioned in a mass of fat so that if you get hit there, it doesn't jump around. And insulation, it's really good insulation in two forms. Thermal insulation, to help you keep yourself warm. You have a layer of fat underneath your skin over your whole body. And electrical insulation, because almost all of the nerves in your body are surrounded by this fatty material called myelin that provides electrical insulation. Okay, saturated and unsaturated. If that's the maximum number of hydrogens, it is saturated. And it's straight, a fatty acid. If the fatty acid has fewer numbers of hydrogens, that means it has to have double bond, at least that one double bond. It's called unsaturated. And that puts a crook in the molecule. So in an earlier picture of the triglyceride, two of the fatty acids right here. This fatty acid and this fatty acid has a maximum number of hydrogens if it's saturated, and it's all single bonds. This one right here is unsaturated. There's a double bond right here. And that means that there's a bend put in the molecule. Okay, a saturated fat has all three of its fatty acids saturated. And we'll learn that saturated fat has a bad reputation for clogging arteries, and your risk for heart disease is directly related to how much saturated fat you eat. And you get saturated fat from eating meat. Animal fats are pretty much saturated, and they easily stack. They tend to be solid at room temperature. So animal fat, you're on that steak or chicken, it's solid at room temperature. Plant fat is generally unsaturated, so it doesn't pack together real well. And therefore it's liquid at room temperature, and that's where the plant oils come from. And atherosclerosis is the building up of plaque inside your arteries, including the opening. And generally saturated fat does that much more readily than unsaturated fat. So here, the types of fat saturated on the left, they're all from animals. Unsaturated fat on the right, plant oils, omega fats, and the worst of the, but here's the thing. One type of unsaturated fat is actually called trans fat, and it's made in the lab. It's an artificial fat, really. And they take perfectly good unsaturated plant oils and they straighten them out. The double bonds are still there, so it's unsaturated. But they straighten out. They don't make them curve. They straighten out that thing. And this is called trans fat or partially hydrogenated vegetable. And it's the absolute worst possible thing you could eat besides like poisons. It is really poison. I mean, it's really, really bad. And it's found mostly in highly processed baking goods, you know, and it used to, like in cakes and cookies, it used to be in chips also, really nasty stuff. It increases your risk for heart disease more than anything else. And I try to completely keep that on my diet. That's just me. If I see it on a food label, I put that thing back on the shelf. I'm not gonna buy anything with trans fat in. Okay, so plant and fish fats. Now here's here's an exception, because fish are animals, but mostly their fat is unsaturated. So here it is, hydrogenation, adds hydrogen, converts unsaturated to saturated. Well, not really. I used to think that, you know, they would take out the double bonds to make trans fat. The double bonds are still there, but they're in a different conformation. It's just like a similar thing between the bonds, between alpha and beta bonds in carbohydrates. Same type of bond, but different orientation. So it's called a cis conformation when you have a bend in the molecule where the double bond is. If you straighten that out, this is called a trans formation, and hence the term trans fat, and it's straight. Makes liquid fats solid room temperature and creates trans fat, a type of saturated fat that's particularly bad for your health. Like the old style margarine. If I see margarine or something, forget it, I'm not eating any margarine. The newer margarines are better. They eliminate trans fat, but the old fashioned type of margarine is like pure trans fat.
Oh.
And one reason trans fat is used in these, in some of these foods in the grocery store is shelf life. It increases shelf life. Fats tend to go rancid. They get turned by oxygen, and it became smelling bad and tasting bad, and then the food goes bad. Trans fat is really resistant to that. It doesn't go rancid nearly as fat, and so it gives longer shelf life to foods in the grocery store. Okay, steroids, very different from fats in structure and function. Carbon skeleton has four fused rings, and steroids vary in the functional groups attached to these set of rings, and its chemical variations affect their function. And they have really important functions in animals, and they're all based on cholesterol. Cholesterol is a steroid, it's the most basic steroid, and it has a bad reputation too of clogging arteries. But there are other important steroids that form steroid hormones in animals, including the sex steroids. And so they are all made from cholesterol. But here's the thing, you can make cholesterol, so you don't have to eat it. You can eat a cholesterol, completely cholesterol-free diet, and you never have to worry about it because you can make the stuff. Cholesterol, key component of cell membranes, the base steroid from which your body produces other steroids, just like the sex steroids, estrogen, and testosterone, or should mostly be estrogen, which are the female sex hormones, and androgens, which are the male sex hormones. And the most common estrogen is called estradiol. The most common androgen is testosterone. And there is the two sex steroids. Here's and so notice how different testosterone and estrogen are. I mean, they're barely different. They have a little bit different functional groups. And so they're really similar molecules, but they have really big differing biological effects. So this is how, you know, take a message of even small changes in molecules can lead to big changes in biological effect, the biological role. So, what do sex steroids do for you? Well, they allow you to make gametes, for one thing. Males making sperm, females making oocytes or eggs. They also are responsible for what are called secondary sexual characteristics. And what that means is lots of animals are what's called sexually dimorphic species. And dimorphic means two forms, male and female. A sexually dimorphic species means that males and females look differently, right? Now, but the only way they look really differently when they're very, very young is the set of genitals they have. So those are primary sexual, characteristics. What set of genitals do you have, okay? Male or female? After puberty, you get what are called secondary sexual characteristics. You start to look different. And what am I talking, and because you start making these sex steroids at puberty, you don't make them when you're a little child. You make them at puberty. We have a very small amount when you're a little child because there's a couple of glands in your over your kidneys called adrenal glands, and they make some sex steroids. So even though children have a little bit of them. But in order to really make gametes to be able to make babies, you need a lot more. And so that's when your gonads, your testes or ovaries come alive and start making lots of sex steroids. So what kind of things am I talking about secondary sexual characters? Well, for one thing, I didn't shave this morning, so I've got a little stubble. So facial hair, females don't have to shave their face. My voice might be a little deeper than most female voices because my vocal cords lengthen under the influence of testosterone. And I have this laryngeal protuberance, also called Adam's apple, it's more prominent in males. I have a higher percentage, males have a higher percentage of muscle than fat, females have the reverse, higher percentage of fat than muscle. And the distribution of body fat is really different on males and females. I was talking about subcutaneous fat underneath the skin. Females develop a much thicker layer of subcutaneous fat, so their bodies are more rounded. Males are more angular. That's a secondary sexual characteristic. And one big one is, and the most obvious one, has to do with breasts. And it's not just breasts. Breasts aren't a secondary sexual characteristic, because I got breasts. Everybody's got breasts, but males have small breasts. Females generally have lots of larger breasts, so they grow larger breasts, and that's one of the most obvious secondary sexual characteristics. Okay, as I mentioned, males naturally have a higher percent of muscle, skeletal muscle, compared to females, and why that is because androgen, testosterone, is a muscle building, and it builds muscle. And that also increases metabolic rate in males, because they have a higher metabolic rate. So here's the thing. So that's kind of what's called an anabolic steroid. So testosterone is a natural anabolic steroid. Anabolic means build up. But synthetic anabolic steroids, they take testosterone in the lab and they tweak it and they make like super androgens that can really build muscle really fast. And so some athletes have used anabolic steroids to become really, really, get really, really big muscles. So they're abused by athletes to build up the muscles quickly, but they can cause serious physical and mental problems. For one thing, the athletes who abuse these steroids, their testicles kind of start to shrivel up because they don't make any, they don't want testosterone anymore. They've got so much testosterone they're taking. And there's also something called roid rage, how they go into these rages because it's high testosterone. And also they have a higher susceptibility to certain cancers because they do this. It's not fair to other students, other athletes who don't take steroids. Therefore, now all athletic competition bans synthetic anabolic steroids. Every single sport bans it. Used to be okay in actually baseball. There was one called androstenedione that you could buy over the counter that it was legal, but not baseball. Bans it. And if you like Olympic athletes, if you win a medal, you get a P2 cup. And these breakdown products of the steroids are in your urine. And once you get detected for that, your medal's taken away, you're banned, and you can't do that. The only sport that maybe still allows anabolic steroids is weightlifting. No, I don't think even weightlifting. But bodybuilding, you know, those guys with pose. Of course, is that a sport? I don't know. Anyway. Okay, so as I just mentioned, most athletic organizations, pretty much all athletic organizations, ban the use of anabolic steroids because of the health hazards compared and also the unfairness. You should get a competitive advantage because you're taking these drugs into your body. And so, okay, down in the lower right-hand corner, Ben Johnson, a Canadian sprinter, he beat Carl Lewis. This is an Olympics back in, I don't know, 70s or something. He beat Carl Lewis, who was our fastest guy, and won a gold medal in 100-meter dash, but was stripped of that. Because he took anabolic steroids. And Carl Lewis was awarded the gold medal. And and the guy who came in fourth, and the guy who came in second, third got the silver, and the guy who came in fourth got the bronze. I think Floyd Lantis on the left side of the bottom, I think he was a swimmer, I think, who abused in box throws. The two top guys, Alex Rodriguez and Mark McGuire, they took steroids, but it was really legal for them. They took, as I mentioned, in baseball, they used to allow, when these guys played, one called Innistrine Diamond. And you can actually buy over the counter. But even, but now baseball, as for years and years now, they've been banned it as well. Okay, proteins. Let's talk about proteins, polymers of amino acids. And the monomers, so the monomer for proteins, are amino acids, account for more than 50% of the dry weight of most cells and are instrumental in almost everything cells do. I mean, the number of things that proteins do is phenomenal. Some are just structural proteins, some are receptors, some are enzymes. They do all kinds of stuff. And really, they're the most complicated of the macromolecules because they have 20 different monomers. See, how many different monomers does carbohydrate have? One, glucose, that's it. Starch, glycogen, cellulose, glucose. Proteins, 20 different kinds. That doesn't mean there's only 20 amino acids that exist. There's lots more than that that exist, but there are only 20 out of that big group, only 20 are used by all living things, the same 20, to make proteins. So, structural proteins, storage proteins, contractile proteins, transport proteins, enzymes, these are all functions of proteins. So, proteins are made by stringing together a common set of 20 different kinds of amino acids. But every amino acid has a basic structure, and they only differ by what's called one functional group on the central carbon. There's one that's called an R group. It can be anything. So let me show you what all amino acids have in common and see how I put them together to form proteins or polypeptides. A peptide is a small protein. A polypeptide is a large protein with lots of amino acids. And you can see that's going to be a dehydration synthesis to do it, just like we did in carbohydrates and lipids. So three of these attachment groups are common to all amino acids. One, a carboxyl group, C double bond OOH. Now we're gonna look more at that structure in lab. We do the molecular model of lab. We'll look at these different functional groups. An amino group, NH2, and a hydrogen atom attached to a central carbon. The variable component of amino acids is called a side chain. It is attached to the fourth bond of the central carbon. So each one of the 20 different amino acids has those three parts there, but the side group is different for every single one of them. So there, in green, the amino group, in pink, the carboxyl group attached to the black central carbon with a hydrogen. And then the yellow is the side chain. And that's the only difference between all amino acids, the side chain. The amino group, the carboxyl group, and the hydrogen, exactly the same for all amino acids. So as I said, each type of amino acid has a unique side chain and gives that amino acid special chemical properties. Okay, examples of amino acids with hydrophilic side chains. So some amino acids are hydrophobic because its side chain is hydrophobic. See, leucine just has carbon and hydrogen. And that's all nonpolar covalent bonds, nonpolar. But if you have a hydroxyl group, like in serine, that becomes a hydrophilic amino acid. That's gonna mix it warm. Cells link amino acids together by dehydration reactions. As I mentioned, just like carbohydrates and lipids, forming what's called peptide bonds. This is a covalent bond between a nitrogen and a carbon that's doubly bonded to oxygen. So it's a special bond you see in proteins, creating long chains of amino acids called polypeptides, and that's a protein. So a functional protein is one or more polypeptide chains precisely twisted and folded and coiled into a molecule of unique shape. And that's the really, really important part. Proteins do their job because of their molecular shape, because of the shape that they have. Okay, so it's really important. That's called tertiary structure, the three-dimensional shape. It's a precise shape, and it's determined by what amino acids are put in what order for them to fold into this particular shape to do this particular job. And usually proteins are really particular in the job that they do. Like enzymes, they usually just do one reaction. They catalyze, they speed up one particular reaction. Receptors usually bind to one thing, one of the molecules. So proteins usually have to work by binding to other molecules. So they have to have complementary shapes in order to bind to the other molecule. Right. So there's two amino acids. Notice the OH on one, H on the other one. What are we gonna make? Two H's and one O, make water. A dehydration reaction to make a peptide bond there between the nitrogen on one amino acid and the double bond, the carbon that's double bonded to the oxygen on the other amino acid. That's called a peptide bond. Okay, so how is it possible to make the huge variety of proteins found in the body from just 20 kinds of amino acids? Well, like the English alphabet, there's only 26 letters in the English alphabet, right? How many words can we make with those letters? Gazillions. That's the same thing with, this is really what we call the language of proteins. There's 20 letters in the alphabet. And you can mix and match those 20 all different kinds of ways to make many, many gazillions of different kinds of proteins. And some proteins are really short. They're like 10, 15, 20 amino acids long. Some are hundreds of amino acids long. Okay, the amino acid sequence of each polypeptide determines the three-dimensional structure of the protein. So the amino acid sequence is called the primary structure. What amino acids are put in what order to make this polypeptide? And the protein's three-dimensional structure enables the molecule to carry out a specific function. And as I mentioned, as I just mentioned, nearly all proteins work by recognizing and binding to some other molecule because they have the correct shape. So anything that changes that shape, and we look at some things that can change the shape, it's going to affect how well that protein works. And we're going to see that actually in the enzyme lab. Okay. So on the left is the amino acid sequence of lysozyme, which is an enzyme. Let's see all the different amino acids in a row. That's called the primary structure or primary sequence. Then it folds into a compact shape on the right called, and its internal structure called secondary structure. Sometimes they're helices, sometimes they're flat sheets. And then the way the whole molecule folds is called the tertiary structure. And sometimes some proteins have more than one polypeptide chain, and that's called tertiary structure. Hemoglobin, molecule that carries oxygen, carbon dioxide in your red blood cells is a protein like that. So all proteins have primary, secondary, tertiary structure. Some of them have quaternary structure. Okay. A slight change in the amino acid sequence can affect the protein's ability to function. Sometimes not. We're going to get to this in genetics and talking about mutations and how changes in genes can lead to a change in a protein. And the most common thing is that change doesn't affect the protein. Second most common is a deleterious change, and that's what most genetic diseases are. They've made a change in a gene that's going to change the amino acid sequence of a protein, like in sickle cell disease. Substitution of one amino acid for another at a particular portion in hemoglobin is 434, I think, amino acids in hemoglobin. One amino acid change leads to sickle cell disease, and it's a genetic disorder. Okay, see, that one, so this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the sixth one in, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, was supposed to be, wait a minute now, 1, 2, 3, whoops, previous. That one change leads to, but they haven't changed it. It's still cystine. Anyway, one change in one amino acid leads to red blood cells turning into a sickle shape in low oxygen conditions. And you start to clog arteries and cause severe pain and so on and so forth. Okay. So one difference in structure is enough to cause the protein to fold into a different shape, which alters its function, which in turn causes disease. So misfolded proteins are associated with many diseases, including some severe nervous system disorders and genetic disorders. And there's also a really bizarre thing called prions. These are misshapen proteins that misshape other proteins and lead to misfolded versions of normal brain proteins. And this is mad cow disease. And it's in people, it's called Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. And if you get one of these misshapen proteins, forget it. Your brain is going to disintegrate and there's nothing you can do about it. And it gets from eating infected nerve tissue from an animal that has these prions. So there's bovine spongiform encephalopathy, which is mad cow. Fatal weight loss in deer, elk, moose is called wasting disease. And it's found in wild deer in this area. So if you go out of deer hunting and you kill a deer, you bring it to the station and they test it to make sure it doesn't have wasting disease. Because if you eat that meat, you're gonna get, you wouldn't get curl. They really should put down what's called Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. That is the human form of this encephalopathy. Kuru was the same thing, but it was due to cannibals. There used to be cannibals in there, I think Papua New Guinea, I think, or somewhere. They used to eat the brains of their enemies. And they had this misshapen protein, these prions, and they got infected and died from Kuru, which is really the same as Creutzfeldt-Jakob, which just happened to come from other humans rather than coming from eating an infected cow or deer or something. A protein shape is sensitive to your environment. Unfavorable change in temperature, pH, or some other factor can cause a protein to unravel. And we're going to see that in lab. We're going to look at the effect of temperature on enzyme function. But usually, if you change the temperature of a protein a little bit, it changes, it doesn't work so well. But you bring it back and you're okay. But if you boil an enzyme or any protein, you boil it, and this is called denaturing, it will irreversibly destroy the three-dimensional shape of the protein and that protein will never work again. Even if you lower the temperature back down, it's done. It's irreversibly changed. pH can do the same thing. You put a protein in a really high or really low pH, it will denature the protein and destroy its shape and therefore its function. Okay, we go on to nucleic acid. So I'm gonna put that in the third video. And this is gonna be 106 life molecules two. Okay, so I'll see you on the flip side here. Let me stop recording.